Any questions? Okay, so we're being recorded. Please feel free to contact me at any time about anything. Okay, I teach a course at Pericles called Approaching Legal English. Pericles offers an LLM course, a program actually, totally in English, taught by lawyers who are native speakers of English. The course is designed for both for law students and for lawyers who want to increase their fluency in English, and it serves as a preparatory course for the Pericles LLM program. It's very good if you have studied English, you've been working for a while, and maybe you've forgotten English, or you just want to improve on the knowledge that you have. I'd just like to say a few words about myself, and that goes simply like this. I love to compare Russian and English in order to find ways to see where the two languages are similar and dissimilar. When I teach, I like to begin with what we know. And what everyone knows, of course, is Russian and Russian grammar. So I like to start there and compare Russian to English. The way I do this is through what I call a guerrilla grammar. We'll get to that in a few moments. Just keep that in mind. So Approaching Legal English is a 12-week course. We meet, we have two classes per week on Tuesdays and Thursdays, beginning next Tuesday, May 26th, through August 13th. It lasts for 2 hours from 19:30 to 21:30. We have a very novel approach in the course. We use a textbook that is not your standard textbook. It's based on a murder mystery that takes place in a law firm in Washington, D.C. We have 12 chapters, 12 weeks. Each week you read a chapter. Each chapter has certain vocabulary words, certain legal concepts, certain legal terms, and specific grammar points. And each week we go through discuss these. Now, what I'd like to try to do today is to simulate, first of all, does everybody understand me? I speak fairly fast. Anybody want me to slow down? Anybody want me to use simpler vocabulary? How do you feel?
No, thank you. Everything is great. Thank you.
Good. Anybody else have any? Fine. Everything's okay. Thank you, Svetlana. I appreciate that. Good. Okay, let's do this. We're going to simulate a bit of a course, a bit of what we do in the course. We can't do everything because each course is 2 hours long and we have to fit what we're doing into less than an hour. So the first thing is I'd like to have discussion. Discussion is kind of the base of what we do. And the thing that everybody is discussing, this thing that everybody is discussing now, of course, is the coronavirus. So I'd like to get your impressions of what your lives are like, what the coronavirus is like, maybe some legal issues involved. I can, you know, think of a few questions. You know, should we have a state of emergency officially proclaimed or not? Does anybody have any legal authority, for example, for restricting our movements? What about this propusk system? It sounds like a military regime, these types of things. Let's think about those things and just talk about them. We're not gonna find any answers, but let's just see what you think. Yeah, okay, ideas, please. Olga, any ideas? Sorry? Victoria? Daria? Leila? Any ideas?
I can speak?
Sure, please go, Olga. I'd love to hear you.
Cool. Actually, I like all the situation. I'm really sorry, first of all, but I really like my life now because I really like working from home. you told us about Propolsk. So I think it's fine. It's fine, really. Okay. I can go once a week to the supermarket, and it's fine, really. Okay. I can go to the countryside. It's fine still. So I really like it now. Maybe in March it was a bit scary, but now I like it.
How interesting.
A little like this.
You're the first person I've heard to say this. That's interesting. Oh, yeah. Anybody agree with Olga? Disagree? Anybody? Okay. Okay, well, I'll give you my opinion. You know, the way I look at it is I'm perfectly fine with it. We've got something very dangerous going on, and I think we all have to kind of get together and try to do whatever we can to make the situation better. If it means staying at home, we stay at home. And, you know, I can do that. Anyone else have any ideas? Daria? No. Anyone else on here who would like to add something? Well, I'd love to have other people adding things, but if we're not talking, we're not talking. There's nothing we can do in class. We do a lot of talking, and I call on people and usually, you know, we answer, we talk. But let's continue on in what else we're going to do then. And by that I mean, question that I have for you. Can anybody name for me what the most significant date is in history for the English language? Anybody? Any idea?
I have a guess.
Good, okay.
Maybe birthday of the, not king, I remember the name of the crown. Elizabeth.
The crowning of Queen Elizabeth?
Yeah, Queen Elizabeth.
Okay, that would have been 1953, I think. Right? Okay.
Oh, no. I mean, her birthday every year. Maybe it's...
Oh, no, I meant what year. Not the date, but what year. What year in history.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah. What year in history is the most important, the most significant for the English language? Mm. Anybody have any ideas? Take a guess.
Maybe something with Churchill.
Okay. Well, I can't tell you the year in which the Henry VIII basically established the Church of England, broke with the Catholic Church, but that would have been sometime in the 1500s. I can't tell you that year, but no, it's considerably before that.
Oh, before.
Before that, yeah. Ideas? No. Okay. Let me go to an actual slide presentation, and we will talk about the year 1066. What happened in 1066? Anybody know? Okay. We had the Norman invasion. The French from Normandy invaded and conquered England. And before that, we had another very interesting situation, actually. And but before we do that, what I'd like to do is talk about how the... Let me ask another question, let's put it differently. How do you think the English legal system differs basically from the Russian legal system? What is the main difference that you can describe? Anybody? Okay,
As I know, in England, it's case legal system.
Mm-hmm.
And we have, I don't remember the name in English, sorry.
Well, say it in Russian. We'll find an English equivalent one way or another.
Okay. I mean, we based on the laws, legislation, and in English, usually we based on cases.
Right. Precedent, yeah. Case yeah, law, precedent.
Yeah,
or on the statutes and the legislation.
Yeah.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Well, strangely enough, the English language itself is pretty much differs in somewhat the same way. And the English language evolved in the same way that common law evolved in Britain, in what is now Britain. So let's move on. And because before 1066, we had earlier invasions. Now, if you can see here, we have England, basically England. We had invasions from the Angles. They came into this part of England. This today, this area of England is still called East Anglia. We had people from Denmark. They came over. Danish is very close to the old English language that is spoken. We had Saxons from here. You combine the Angles and the Saxons together and we come up with what is called the Anglo-Saxon language, that which is the language that is used before 1066. We had invasions of the Vikings from Norway up here. Now, imagine what would happen if you took a desert island and we have Russians, Poles, and Bulgarians who come there. They all basically understand each other. And over time, they evolve their own language, which is kind of a conglomerate of all three. That's what happened in England. All of these languages that were spoken were more or less the same, Germanic in origin. And what they did is they evolved what was called Old English or Anglo-Saxon. Now, if we look, let's move now a few years ahead from this. This is like in the 800s. If we move forward to, let's say, about 1,000 years ago, 50 years before the Norman invasion, what we have is what was called Dane law. Now, Dane law refers to an area, well, it can be referred to an area here. And you can see it is actually said the Dane law. This was where Danish law was used in England. Now, let's move 50 years forward more, and we'll go back to the Norman invasion. Normans come in, conquer England. And what then happens? Within 5 years of this period, French replaces the old Anglo-Saxon as the official language. And anybody who is anybody in society, in the court, in the, the royal court, in the court system, the legal system itself, in the church, has to use French or Latin. Okay, that's just basically what I wanted to show you there, because it's a very interesting situation that we have. What this all means is, and this is what we talk about in the course, the Norman invasion brought us a second language. We had underneath, we had a Germanic Anglo-Saxon. On top of that, we had a French. And pretty soon these languages started melding together. So we really have two sets of vocabularies in English. We use the French words when we want to express something academic. Quite often we use French terms when we're doing legal things. This is how we express erudition. Our Germanic words are often short, much shorter than generally the French words, and we use them to express our emotions. For example, all phrasal verbs that we have in English, everybody is always troubled with phrasal verbs. They're of Germanic origin. Anything French doesn't have a way of even using Germanic phrasal verbs. It just doesn't exist. The structure doesn't allow it. So what we've got is we've got two vocabularies, really. For example, if I take the word thoughtful, you know, something that you think about, zadumshivi in general, that tells you I'm thinking about something, or I'm thoughtful, helpful to somebody else, I'm thinking about it. Germanic origin. If I take another English word, pensive, that comes from French, which means, penser in French means to think. Translated also as zadumshivi. But we have a nuance here, a little bit different. When we say pensive, there's a melancholy involved in it. And we go on and on with these types of nuances between the two languages. If we take a word like credit, we have all kinds of words that we use involving credit, whereas in Russian, we just usually say kredit. Kredit means all kinds of different things in English, and we can't use credit for this word. We have to use credit for this word, for example. So we'll study these different words. If I take the word mashenichestvo, for example, I can come up with approximately 8 to 10 different words that mean the same thing. Some of these words are actual legal terms. Others are just words that are in the general lexicon, English lexicon. When we get to my favorite, afiora, afiorist, same thing. There are just so many ways of saying things. So vocabulary, we have two sets of vocabulary. And this gives English a whole rich variation that we can talk about. We have two verb systems, two types of subjunctives, for example. We have two systems for comparison. We say prettier, Germanic, but we say more beautiful, French style. We have two negation systems. And Russian speakers often mix the negation systems. They come up with, say, I have no any book. No, can't do that. It doesn't work. In fact, we really have two separate grammars, a Germanic-based grammar and a French Latin-based grammar. And we talk about these. This fact that we've got these two different grammars, these two different grammatical systems, causes a lot of problems. And when we use them simultaneously, we run into these problems. And this brings me to what I like to talk about is what I call a guerrilla grammar. Let me show you what I mean by guerrilla grammar. I want to do another demonstration, and that demonstration will be here. Okay, now, when I say guerrilla grammar, here's what I mean. I don't mean a gorilla, I mean a gorilla. Anybody know what the difference is? No? Okay, well, a gorilla is what we call a big monkey, but a gorilla is a partisan.
Guys, be proactive. Ask questions to Donald. Be proactive. I mean,
Putting
your mics on and participate in the discussion. You have to learn how to, you know, basically form a question even.
Yeah. Stop me if you don't understand anything. Why do you call it a gorilla grammar? Why is it a gorilla? And why? What are the two words? Ask questions. Anybody? Okay, well, we'll go on and we'll come up with other questions later. So let's talk about what this guerrilla grammar is, or what guerrillas do, partisans. Okay, a guerrilla fighter, you know, in war, they live in the forest, the enemy comes along, they come out of the forest, they attack the problem right then, they fix the problem with whatever means they have and with the available resources, and then they go away. A guerrilla grammar does pretty much the same thing. We go to the heart of the problem. We don't look at all of the rules of grammar that you might feel that you're supposed to learn. You might know them and you might not use them. The reason that we don't look at all of them is because when you're talking, you don't have time to pick and choose this rule and make it work. If you do that, you stop the conversation, or else by the time you choose your correct word, the conversation has gone on to something else. So a guerrilla grammar goes to the heart of the problem. We find a simple way of fixing it, and we use what we already know. And quite often what we already know is Russian grammar. Everybody understand what I'm talking about in a guerrilla grammar? Olga?
Yes,
I understand. Okay, good. Okay, good. Anybody else? No? Okay, fine. I'm going to go on with an example of how a guerrilla grammar works, and that is we have a problem with word order in English. It looks very simple, but it can be difficult. For example, okay, statements and questions and reported speech. So, somebody tell me how you say in Russian, he is reading a book.
Он читает книгу.
Beautiful. Он читает книгу. Now notice how он читает comes in this order. Он читает, A, B. And it works the same way in English, A, B. Now make this one a question in Russian.
Он читает книгу.
Uh-huh, он читает книгу. We've got the same thing, A, B. How do you say it in English?
So we just replace the verb and the subject.
Exactly.
Is he reading?
Is he reading a book? Exactly, good, okay. But we've got not A, B, we've got B, A. Nobody has any problems so far. Everybody knows that, that's simple. But what happens when I want to say in Russian, oops, when I want to say in English, this.
Don't know, is he reading a book?
No.
I don't know whether he's reading a book.
Okay, whether, if he is reading a book, okay? You see? Here we've gone to this BA, BA, and we've made it AB. The problem here is in this. So many Russians will say, I don't know. Well, you wouldn't do it this way. I'll give you an example in a minute. But what I want to say is, don't do this up here. Do this down here. This is really important, especially with reported speech. Reported speech is they said, they explained, they described, they wrote, something like this. Everybody knows what reported speech is. An example. A Russian speaker will often say he emphasized what are the criteria for making a decision. Now, what does that mean? Is it a question or a statement?
It's a statement.
It's a statement. But when I hear that, he emphasizes what are the criteria for making a decision. I don't know what it is. I don't know whether it's a question or a statement. And it sounds strange to me. So if you say that, while I'm trying to figure out what this is, whether you're making a statement or you're asking me a question that I'm supposed to answer, you've gone on talking and basically you've lost me as your listener or your reader. So what you have to do is, he emphasized what the criteria are for making the decision. Now I understand, now we can go on. So this is in short what a guerrilla grammar is. Now, granted, this is a fairly easy example that I've given you, but it's typical. And this is one of the chief mistakes, one of the top 20-25 mistakes that Russian speakers make. You can't write this way, you can't speak this way when you're dealing with clients. So basically, that is all that I wanted to say in terms of a presentation. This is the kind of stuff that we go through in approaching legal English. We have a lot of fun. We work a lot. We speak a lot. And I'd just like to hear what your reactions are. What do you want to do? What are your interests? If you were to sign up for Approaching Legal English, what would you like to do? Alternatively, what are you doing right now? And how do you use English? Let's just talk things out. Ideas, anyone? Anna, are you there? I can see your picture. Olga, anything more?
Well, hello, my name is Victoria.
Victoria.
For example, usually I write some kind of memos or due diligence reports in English. I'm an associate and I generally deal with real estate. So I write a lot on real estate.
You write a lot, sure. I bet probably what, 70% of your work is in written form. Am I correct?
I missed the question, sorry.
Yeah, I'll just repeat it. It wasn't a question. It was kind of a half question. I said probably what you do is 70% in writing. Yeah? Did you hear me or not? Maybe not. Okay. Do you do it in English?
English, but runglish, something like this, because of rephrasing and stuff. Yes.
So I think that is hard. Very, exactly.
It's an essential thing.
Well, we talk a lot about how to get out of runglish and into English. Basically, you start out by writing short sentences. You can write long, you know, Tolstoy-like sentences in Russian. You have to be Hemingway when you get to English. It's really difficult. There are lots of problems. Anybody else do a lot of writing in English?
I do some writing. I work in an international company. We give some loans to the people from Asia. So most of my work in English. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I draft some agreements, some other documents. And of course, I most of my colleagues speak English or speak.
Okay.
Don't speak Russian, I mean.
Right. No, I can imagine. Yeah. Not internationally, of course not, yeah.
So I need both and communication and writing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Actually, I have problems with writing emails. I think sometimes it's polite in Russian, it's okay in Russian, but it's not polite in English. And I have this problem.
It's very strange because email is something between formal writing and kind of informal street language, but it has a limitation on its informalities. And I think over the years, or, you know, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when it first appeared, things were very loose. And you could be very talkative, very colloquial. Now it has more strict forms that we use, but it's different than writing a formal letter that you send in the mail, dear Mr. Jones, like this. And it certainly is different from contract language, but you still have to be careful. What are some of the problems that you encounter?
I think sometimes I write really straight. I just write, for example, dear Donald, and then please do something.
Mm-hmm.
Something like this. And I understand now that it's not really what I should write.
Well, you know, you can actually. For some reason, I'm in Russian here and I'm trying to send you a message. we often do things that we call straight from the shoulder. You know, it's mm-hmm. a boxing term, straight from the shoulder, a punch. And as long as you remain polite, you can do that. Where you say, you know, dear Donald, would you please do such and such for me? That's perfectly fine. I mean, I do it all the time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Well, interesting. Yeah, sometimes I think that some of the emails from my colleagues are more polite, and probably I would like to write like them, but not okay. like me. But okay. of course, it depends. Yeah.
Let me give you a little bit of simple advice. Use would you, could you, a lot.
Yeah,
it's
yeah,
a polite.
Yeah.
It's the polite way of saying things. It covers all kinds of difficulties. It gets you through a lot of things. Don't be afraid to speak straight from the shoulder. Okay. Don't be afraid to write short sentences. Usually, when you write something short, laconic, you say what you need, and then in another sentence you explain maybe some of the details, it works out much better. So try to avoid your lengthy Tolstoy Russian sentences and come into your more American Hemingway sentences, for example. Mm-hmm. Okay, anybody else thanks. Have any questions about writing emails or, let's say, formal letters, contracts? No? Okay, Anna, are you there? Do you want to say anything? And I think, oh, Victoria, how about you? Anything further?
Well, contracts are also very, very important thing. You mentioned them. So mm-hmm. yes, usually I have some contracts which I should draft. Mm-hmm. Yes, it's mm-hmm. also mm-hmm. very, very important.
Yeah. Well, one of the courses in the LLM program is the language of contracts. Marion Dent, our dean at Pericles, teaches that course, and you'll go through everything from A to Z. It's a very intensive and a very complete course, and she knows how to write contracts, believe me. So we look at approaching legal English as, say, laying the basis for the other courses that follow in the LLM program. And of course, the language of contracts would be one of them. Do you have any particular difficulties with contract language?
Not particular difficulties, but maybe difficulties in general, because they have a very special structure mm-hmm. and very special sentence structure. Exactly. Usually it's used reported speech or something like this, passive mm-hmm. voice. So, well, you don't speak like you write in contracts. So.
No, absolutely not. No, not at all. And now when you write your contracts, do you have a prevailing language or are both languages equally valid?
Usually I write leases or sale and purchase agreement. I don't deal with, sometimes I deal with, but don't usually deal with something which is called M&A. So mm-hmm, and, mm-hmm. Leases and sale and purchase of real estate, they are generally should be under Russian law, so Russian language prevails. Mm-hmm. But if our client or the party is in some not Russian, so contract could be bilingual. And if we redraft Russian part, so the English part right. should be also redrafted.
Right, exactly. Yes. Yeah. Well, if you're translating your Russian contracts into English, that's difficult because Russian contracts are, again, they're the Tolstoy versions. And quite often you just totally lose your meaning in English when you do that.
Yes.
Do you work to standard contracts where you kind of fill in the blanks each time?
No, not actually. Sometimes we work with the draft which is provided by the client. Sometimes we take our draft. Sometimes we take the draft of the counterparty. So we don't have any standard format.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So you're doing a lot, translating from Russian to English, translating from English to Russian, back and forth, making things come together this way. Right?
Yes,
sometimes. It sounds difficult. It also sounds fascinating.
Sometimes it's really difficult because you can't explain in English what you want to be.
Right, exactly. And for example, some of the terms in Russian reality don't really exist in English, you know? It's hard to find good equivalents. Anybody else want to talk about contracts, writing in general, differences between English and Russian, legal language in general? Okay, well, basically I think we are pretty much finished. We are supposed to do this within 1 hour. I will repeat my contact information. Feel free to, if you want to talk about anything, send me an email, send me a Skype, a message with your address. Say, Donald, I want to talk to you. Let's talk about something for 15 minutes, something like that. I'm open to all kinds of things. So please feel free.